Well, good evening, everyone. I'm Lynn Kyle. I'm the head of the Girls Division, and I'm thrilled to be able to welcome you to tonight's perspective lecture on the subject of entrepreneurship. We know that this is a hugely popular topic, one which you are very keen to hear more about, and that's reflected in the very large audience that we have for tonight's lecture. So, a warm welcome. And a particular welcome to some of our old boys and old girls, Rob, Chris, Charlotte, and Catherine, who are here to talk to you tonight. If, as a member of the audience, you have questions throughout any of the panelists' talk, please do enter those in the chat box, and we will curate those questions and field them later on in the talk. So please do enter those as we go along. So I'm going to pass over now to Maya, one of our sixth form pupils, who is going to introduce each of our speakers.
Before I give you all a brief introduction about each one of our guest speakers, I just wanted to introduce myself. I'm Maya Brennan, a member of Year 13, and my initial interest in entrepreneurship sparked probably in business GCSE, but my passion has grown so much further, even completing the entrepreneurship scheme offered to Year 12s. The plan for the future is to study international business management, with my electives being heavily focused on entrepreneurship. Anyway, enough about me. I'm going to start my brief introductions about each one of our speakers for tonight. So, after leaving Bolton in 1982, Rob Dobson gained a first-class degree in electronic engineering from the University of Southampton. He then founded Axtix, an algorithmic optimization tech business, whilst also being one of the most active angel investors in Scotland. Rob was also the Boys Division prize-giving speaker in June 2017 and the Primary Division's inaugural Houlton Lecture speaker in May 2023. Moving on to Krish Patel. Krish shows how a person can change their values to impact our world. He created Tales to Inspire, a platform and social enterprise to share people's real-life stories and to encourage outcomes which inspire change. Krish also founded Story Oak, which captures people's life stories on film and passes these on to their family members so no family story goes untold. Charlotte Morley completed a geography degree at Cambridge University before spending the next 10 years working in intelligence, tackling national threats. However, Charlotte still believed that sustainability is where she could create the greatest impact, so moved into tech to build raising consumer products. As a result, Charlotte founded Little Loop whilst also working as head of digital product at Not on the High Street, leaving her role to grow it full time. She described it as the biggest risk she'd ever taken and the best thing she could imagine doing for her children's future. And last but not least, Catherine Swift. Catherine had a successful career in media and fundraising when, unfortunately, her mum was diagnosed with stage 3 breast cancer in January 2010. This completely changed the course of her career. Catherine started working tirelessly with the breast cancer charity that funds world-class research, spending lots of her time in the research unit itself. The research director had an interest in antioxidants, resulting in Catherine finding out about the potential green tea had to fight disease. This resulted in both Catherine and her mum drinking matcha day in and day out, feeling the benefits of the tea. This resulted in Catherine launching OMG Tea, a specialist matcha tea company. Almost 10 years on, and the brand is stocked in Selfridges, Harvey Nichols, and Ocado, just to name a few. Let me now pass on to our first guest speaker, Charlotte Morley.
Thank you so much, Maya, and thank you everyone for being here. It's my absolute pleasure to be here, and I'm hopefully going to be able to tell you a little bit more about me, but more importantly, about why you might want to pursue a career in entrepreneurship and the skills that you might need to do that. Maya's actually done a great job of telling you about my background. I did start my career with a geography degree, which probably says an awful lot about me and is a real precursor to why I became an entrepreneur. But I love the variety that came with geography, the fact that I could do any number of different things, that I learned lots of different subjects, and that I was never and that really is the heart of entrepreneurship, which I'll come back to in a bit. After that, I did go into intelligence. I spent 10 years doing the most incredible job. Again, a job which saw me changing roles every couple of years, doing lots of different things. I was an expert on various different subject areas. I learned a range of skills from investigation and analysis to project management, operational planning, and it was fantastic. I then moved into teaching. I'll explain a little bit about why I moved in a second. And then I moved into tech and I became a digital product lead. Finally, after I had my second child, I decided that I would take those skills and set up my own business. My business is called The Little Loop. It is a clothing rental and resale business. And we aim to make it easier for parents and more cost effective for parents to keep their clothes in circulation. So reducing the waste that's produced through clothing our kids, reducing the cost of it, ultimately benefiting the planet. We were on Dragon's Den in 2022. It was reshown a couple of weeks back, actually. So you might have seen us before, and it's been a hell of a ride. Before I talk more, I'd like to just go sideways a little bit to a definition of entrepreneurship that I got from ChatGPT of all places today. It might not be the perfect definition, but I found it really interesting. And the definition was that entrepreneurship is the process of starting and running a business, taking on financial risks in the hope of profit. Now, I'd actually change that. I'd suggest that it's not just taking on financial risk, it's taking on emotional risk, reputational risk, life risk. And it's not just in the hope of profit. I'd say it's in the hope of impact. The impact might be making profit, making lots of money, but it might be more charitable or philanthropic, like with Krish. Or you might just want to create something which benefits the world in some way, which is really where my journey began. I loved my job in intelligence, as I've said, but I realized that we weren't really changing the world for the better. That's why I went into it. That's why I went to work for the government, make policy, make the world better. That was what I thought when I was 18. But actually, all we did was kind of fight fires. And we were never changing the cause of what was causing the extremism and that we were looking at. On the other hand, I was watching businesses all around me, managing to address societal challenges and really having a positive impact. So to take an example, which wasn't around at the time, but more recently, Elon Musk has arguably made more impact on the transition to clean motoring than any government policy ever could, because he's created a desirable product, which has made it cool to be green. So I think, you know, I was seeing this going on, thinking business is actually changing the world faster. It's more innovative. It can move quicker. And so I moved into technology thinking, actually, if I can learn to build tech, if I can understand how it works, I can start to make things which change the way that people do things. And I would say that my first kind of tip, if you like, is that before you set out on an entrepreneurial journey, you need to define the impact that you want to have. Is it financial or is it something else? For me, it was definitely the chance to solve real world problems. Problem solving is my passion. I get out of bed every morning excited because I get to change the way we do things. I get to solve problems for real people. And every day in our office, we are discussing in great detail the overall problem we're trying to solve, the reduction of waste in the children's clothing industry, but also the tiny details that the issues that users are having with our product itself, with our website, with the way that our service works. And the number one focus and driver of any business should be solving real world problems. If you can solve problems and do it really well, especially better than your competition, you'll be more likely to succeed. And there's nothing more exciting than when someone writes to you or messages you to say, thank you, you've genuinely helped me. You've solved a problem that I had. Something that goes hand in hand with problem solving and the way you solve problems is innovation and creativity. And this is a real skill that you must have to be an entrepreneur, or a skill that you must be able to get from the people around you. To solve problems better than they've been solved before takes having a different mindset. It's not just enough to build what someone else has built and do it slightly better. It's a waste, really, to do that. And actually, you're less likely to succeed. But if you can break down a problem and really think carefully about why it's not been solved before, you're halfway there. And if you're not especially creative, then take another skill of entrepreneurship, which is an abundance mentality. Speak to the people around you, speak to everybody about that problem. What do they think about it? How would they solve it? It's quite tempting, particularly as an entrepreneur, particularly when you're working on your own, to think, I've got to solve this problem. I've got to be right and I've got to deliver my ideas. But actually, you've got to talk to other people. You've got to get all of those ideas and bring them together. And then you're going to come up together with a much better solution. You're more likely to have a successful business. Another real big driver for me and for entrepreneurship, and the thing that I get through my business, is the freedom and autonomy that it brings. Entrepreneurs do have somewhat more control over their destiny than being in a traditional job. You can work more flexibly, and your drivers are different, particularly passion. You know, you're driven by the passion to make your business succeed, which is hard to get from your normal job and a real privilege. However, it means you need to have huge self-drive. There's nobody sitting behind you saying, why have you not done that thing? Or this is what you need to do next. You've got to do it yourself. You've got to be self-motivated, and you'll be doing every role in your own business. When you first start, you'll have no money or very small amounts of money, and you have to do everything. Now that is brilliant for someone like me who needs lots of variety and stimulation. I'm sure my teachers, if they could remember back to those days, would think, yep, that defines Charlotte quite well. Focusing on one thing constantly was not my forte, never has been. And I love the variety and stimulation that comes from my role. It's the best thing about it. But if you're a person who likes to sit and focus on one thing until it's completed to perfection, entrepreneurship might not be for you. You learn and develop so much as an entrepreneur because of all the different things that you get to do. I consider myself 100% more employable now than I was before. I understand from the very core of a business what makes it tick. I've seen and done so many things I'd never have done working for someone else. I've got financial skills, the ability to talk with anyone from any walk of life. I can do social media, I can do design, I can do technology speaking. And of course, I've even been on TV, which is something that you don't often get to do and is, again, a real privilege of this life as an entrepreneur. This life as an entrepreneur for me has been fantastic. Dragon's Den was just incredible, probably the highest point of the whole thing. Meeting the dragons, getting in front of the television cameras and successfully pitching for investment. And I now get to meet Deborah Meaden and Stephen Bartlett, you know, every 6 months or so, and they're great people to know. I've been lucky enough to meet the Prime Minister at 10 Downing Street. I've spoken on stages all over the country, including back at school, which was a genuine high point for me. We've won awards. And also, and this is another fantastic part about building a business, I've built a team of incredible people who I allow to work flexibly and who I've given a career to and I get to work with and help develop. And again, it's a massive privilege and something that I absolutely love. So all in all, for me, entrepreneurship is the perfect career and I'm incredibly passionate about it. But there are obviously things that you need to be able to do in order to make it work. Something I think I should mention, because I think this is what a lot of people expect from an entrepreneurship talk, is financial reward. It's definitely a huge motivator and it's also a necessity. A business which doesn't make money won't survive and it won't be able to raise more money from investors in order to scale. But it's risky. Only 10% of startups succeed. And it does take years of sacrifice to achieve success. Unless you're very lucky, you won't be earning a massive salary overnight, if at all. So I'd say money needs to be important to you. But if that's your only driver, you might be better with a high paid career with a stable salary where someone else gets to take all the risk. But if any of the things that I've mentioned appeal to you, then absolutely go for it. You definitely need to be resilient to be an entrepreneur, but in my opinion, there's nothing quite like it. And the opportunity to leave a legacy, to do good and make real change just can't be beaten. That's me. And I think I'm handing back over to Maya, possibly.
It's to me. Thank you so much, Charlotte. It was really inspiring, but also realistic as well, the way you talked about what it means to be an entrepreneur, a problem solver, and the effects of innovation on the world generally. Our next speaker is Rob Dobson. He's our tech entrepreneur who founded the mobile phone network optimization business, Actix.
Thanks so much. for the introduction. And yes, I'm very delighted to be talking to you all. I think that was also an excellent talk by Charlotte, and I'll try to hit a few of the same notes and maybe a few different ones as well. I think I see entrepreneurship as a slightly broader kind of idea, in the sense that I feel that it's about following your passion and ideas in it, sort of regardless of whether you're in a kind of conventional career or actually have your own business, or in that more risky part of the entrepreneurial landscape. I think many of the skills that are needed and that you develop as an entrepreneur are really about your communication, about the way that you interact with other people, about how you kind of talk about your ideas and your passion and the way that you pursue them. And you can follow many of those things, many of which involve the kind of skills that Charlotte was talking about, a broad range of skills, but you can follow those aspects in all walks of life, in my opinion. And as Charlotte said, including non-profit as well as business, and whether you're actually running a piece of somebody else's business, I still feel that you can follow those entrepreneurial ideas. For me, my passion started in when I was very young. I really loved making things, and I think it really came home to me that I should pursue that as in my life and my career. When my uncle gave me an electronics kit, I was probably 13 or 14. My parents were also want to say that I always wanted to be my own boss. But I suspect that was probably because I just didn't do what they told me to do. But I would encourage anyone at any age to work out what they're passionate about. Obviously, for me, it kind of started when I was relatively young, and that's very fortunate. But I think if you can work out what you're passionate about and engineer that into more and more of your life as you develop different aspects of your life and your career, then that is kind of entrepreneurship of a form in my view. So just going on to my particular journey, I studied electronics and software at university. And on leaving university, I had a choice. I was offered a job at a large US software company. And I also was offered a job by my tutor at the university, who had a small consultancy company. And I chose the small route, and I think it was the right choice for me. I'm pretty certain that it was. And I've thought about this a lot since then. And I feel that if my advice to anybody would be that if you're faced with that kind of decision, I would always suggest that you go for the more entrepreneurial option, because a lot of people get stuck in careers where politics is rife and there isn't a great deal of passion. And you can always, as Charlotte mentioned, an entrepreneurial route will build skills, many, many skills in your armory, and you will become massively more employable. So if you then do decide to switch to a large company or a different route for your life and your career, you're going to be in a much better position, because you will have a much stronger set of skills at that point. So I would advocate for going the entrepreneurial route at all junctures where you have some kind of choice. So on joining this small company, I stayed there for a couple of years. And in fact, we did actually develop the world's first remotely readable water meter, a sort of claim to fame of the company, but it was relatively short-lived as a company, as the professor at the university wasn't particularly interested in it. And I was more ambitious and decided to take the plunge and started a company with at that time four other people. So we didn't have any funds. We didn't have really any money. And we worked for quite a lot. Well, all of that company's lifetime, we worked in a cow shed that was converted on a kind of industrial estate, which was kind of amusing. I think most of the other people in the other units were kind of woodworking people and, you know, local artists, which made us stand out a little. And we were initially quite successful, but we were useless at sales and marketing. We didn't even really understand what it was. And at the point that the kind of turn in our fortunes came, as it was kind of inevitably going to, since we weren't really selling very well, I left and started up on my own. And at that point, I was reasonably confident in my own abilities. And I'd obviously worked in this sort of consultancy, electronics consultancy space for a few years. And I got some projects in various industries. And then I was fortunate to get a project in the mobile phone industry with a company that is now called EE. And, you know, but at that time, there were fewer than 100 people in the business. And the first project I got, in fact, the first few projects I got were not really that interesting, but I over-delivered on the projects I got, and I made sure that they were impressed with me. And my focus was really on developing my skills and also developing to a point where I would get more interesting work. And that fortunately happened after a few months or maybe a bit more. The next few projects I got were much more interesting, much more kind of cutting edge, and also my kind of reputation had grown a little bit, so I started to get some work from other mobile phone companies. And it may sound as though I was some sort of amazing person doing these projects, but actually I was just a bit fortunate in that the industry was growing. There were not actually that many people around who had any kind of skills in that space. And I'd tried very hard to develop some skills to build my knowledge of what was at that time a very, very new industry. But after about 3 years of running that business, I had employed some people. I think we'd probably got to about 15 people by that time, and the business was going okay. But I'd always really wanted to make things, and I wanted to make my own things and really my own products. So we started working on an idea that we had, and found that it was very hard to work on consultancy and products at the same time. But we just kept going at it, which I think is one of the most important attributes of an entrepreneur who's trying to plow their own furrow. You have to be patient, and you have to be determined, and you have to just keep going regardless of setbacks and problems. But actually, this was a hardware product, and unfortunately, our manufacturing abilities were pretty limited, and our sales and marketing skills still weren't very good. So we didn't actually sell very much. But we did manage to find, or did manage to be approached by a US company that had offered to pay for the rights to manufacture and sell the product. And they were a large company, had production, factory production, and so on. So it turned out to be a good move. And it allowed us to think a bit further about what we were trying to do, and realize that actually the hardware side was going to be really hard for a small company, but we were actually pretty good at software as well. So we decided to develop a software product. And after about 5 years and work on that product, five more years, we were up to about 50 people, or maybe that's 5 years in total. And at that stage, I met a brilliant person who I managed to persuade to chair the company and mentor me. And we found that we were good at software, and we grew fast. And, you know, as I said, the industry was growing, so we were in a good place. So, you know, if you are getting a little bit further along with your entrepreneurial thinking, you know, do look for markets that are growing, because that's where the opportunity is going to be. And don't just assume that everybody else is going to flood in. because actually it takes quite a long time for other people to shift what they're doing, especially if they're larger companies. So that's where smaller companies that can be really agile can spot a trend or an opportunity in a market and really grow quickly. And we did grow quickly. We grew fast. We won a lot of awards for growth and profit over those years. And I led the company through another 5 years of rapid growth to the point where we were about 150 people. And at that time, I started thinking that I wanted to change personally. My life was mainly just traveling around the world and managing people. I was meeting customers, I was going to conferences, but I wasn't really doing a lot of the things that I really wanted to do. And also, we just started a family. So I had a kind of very young child at that point. So I thought hard about it, talked to my mentor about it, the chair of the company, and eventually decided that the best thing to do would be to sell the company, which is actually a whole story on its own, and I won't go into that. But eventually, after a couple of false starts, we managed to sell the company, and it turned out that it was in a good time to sell. It was in a year when our profits hit about £10 million, and we had, at that point, about 250 people in 12 countries. So it really was getting to the point where I didn't feel I had the skills then to, or didn't really even want to develop the skills to develop what was now a medium-sized business, I guess. And I really wanted to get back to something, more like my roots of small businesses and so on. So soon after I sold the company, I started mentoring other companies and founders of those companies and started investing in them. And I found that I really enjoyed doing that. I like working with ambitious people, with young people who have ideas and passion. And now I've invested in about 50, well, a lot more than 50 companies, actually. Had four more exits from those companies very successfully. And personally, I just really enjoy helping young people realize their dreams. I think it's a fantastic position that I've managed to get myself into, where I can do something to help people to do that, which I really enjoy. I was also involved in starting the entrepreneurship program at Bolton School. And, again, I really enjoy what that's already brought, and we're only 2 years in. So I think really the sky's the limit with that too. So with that, I'll hand back over to...
Thanks, Rob. So again, some really, really good advice for our young people, especially that idea of choosing entrepreneurship at any opportunity, whether that's going to be as your employees or within your own business as well. Our next speaker is Krish Patel, who is a social enterprise entrepreneur. He founded Tales to Inspire and Story Oak, which are both based around sharing of real life stories. So passing over to you, Krish.
Thank you so much. So hello, everyone. Hope everyone's okay. And thank you. Wow, I really enjoyed that myself. I've just been taking so many notes down. It's been incredible. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about my story, how this is all came about, and we'll just go from there. So essentially, left school in 2008, and I was a very different person to who I am today. I was a footballer. Everything I'd cared about was all about sports, and in particular football. When I left in 2008, I left at 16 years old to go and essentially become a professional football player. I got a scholarship at Bury, and I then got a professional contract. Onto what I thought was going to be the dream. I got to play against some of the best players in the world, some of my idols, and I thought I was going to make it. I got injured, things didn't go as planned, and I found myself not really knowing what I was going to do with my life. I was 20 years old, and I was like, what's next? And I got an email to essentially offer me a full ride scholarship to go and play soccer in America. So I headed over to initially California to go and play soccer and to get my degree as well. And I stayed over there for 6 years, essentially, And the first 4 years, I was essentially getting my degree and got my degree in business, as it happens. And life was amazing. Life was amazing. It was tough. And there were so many hurdles that we don't have enough time to go into today to talk about. But essentially, I cared about very materialistic things. My life was always about the materialistic things. And something happened to me, quite a few things happened to me in America, where I started caring about people. And then people started to come into my space and seek advice and just to share where they were at in their life. And I had no idea why this was happening, but it mattered to me and I started to care about people. So in 2016, I was 24 at the time. I decided after I graduated that my life had been about me and I wanted to do something bigger. So I decided I was going to run 4 marathons in 4 days from the northwest of England to the northeast. And I was going to go over to Uganda and I was going to volunteer. It was completely random. My parents thought I was absolutely mad. I'd never run a marathon before. I'd never been to Africa before. I'd never even volunteered before, right? I'd never done any of this stuff. But it was something that I really wanted to do to develop and learn and to see what was going to happen. I ended up raising over £10,000 in the process. And I headed over to Uganda and I volunteered with children with disabilities. I coached football. I worked with homeless children. And I did so many incredible things. And it opened my eyes to a whole new world. I ended up building, helping to build a schoolhouse there, and that to this day educates 150 people. And like I said, I was 24 at the time and I had no idea what I was doing. Honestly, I had zero idea. I just had one huge, huge determination to make a difference and an impact and to learn. I really wanted to learn about what life was about. I came back home in 2018. I came back to good old Bolton and the land of the clouds, as I always say, you all know. And essentially, I came back and there was homeless people everywhere. I was so surprised at the amount of homeless people I saw in Bolton and in Manchester. And I started to volunteer with a homeless outreach group. In that time, I started to get quite a bit of abuse from people that I wouldn't expect, saying that if they're not willing to help themselves, who do you think you are trying to help them? And you can't teach an old dog new tricks and all these kind of negativity. And I decided to do something a bit daft again. I swam 53 miles, all the lakes in the Lake District, and called it the Swim for Shelter campaign with my aim of helping homeless people go from the streets back to their feet. That was in 2019, and I ended up helping 36 homeless people go from the streets into employment with an amazing charity in Manchester called the Booth Centre. Now, I know this is about entrepreneurialism, and I know that I've not talked about anything about being an entrepreneur as of yet, but there's a lot of key qualities that came about to this point. Being a sports person, having to lead a team, the determination to win, connecting to others, bringing people together towards a common goal. All of those things came to a head in 2019 when I was doing a job that I didn't particularly enjoy. And I decided, right, I'm going to go for this and I'm just going to go for it. So I decided I was going to start something called Tales to Inspire. I'd been inspired by so many people's stories in my life. And I decided that I was going to share people's stories on a platform, real life people's stories to create real life change. It was a very simple idea. And I interviewed people, I put it onto a blog and I put helplines at the bottom for people. I got a lot of stick, even for my own family. It's not a business. You can't even make money. Where do you make money from this? There was other things like it's already been done. There's Humans of New York and there's podcasts and there's blogs. Why are you doing this? And I was like, you know what? It feels right. And I felt like I was going to do something that was going to make a difference. Within 3 days, the first story we shared had been read in 15 countries around the world. Tales to Inspire then developed into not just a blog, but a podcast. Then I developed it into a not-for-profit organization because I realized that everything was going back into the company anyway. And essentially, everything was based in the heart of the community and to try to raise awareness, make a difference in individuals, people's lives, and also in systems. So it just made sense to become a social enterprise and a not-for-profit organization. From there, things really, really went wild. Schools reached out, can you deliver workshops and programs? Then the corporate space reached out, can you deliver workshops, programs, and bring the people that we've shared the stories of into there to really build that real-life connection and empathy. That was 2019. Now we are where we are. Things have just completely been amazing. I was asked to be a TEDx speaker, and it's been a lot of fun. It's definitely been difficult. I do not want to glorify being an entrepreneur. It is tough. Like, I think it's Charlotte said it, but it is definitely one of the hardest things I've ever done, but it's also one of the most joyful things I've ever done. And I've got so much out of it. On top of that, in February of this year, I officially launched Story Oak. So Story Oak came to fruition because in 2019, a busy year for me, I always wanted to interview my granddad. And I wanted to capture his life story on film so we'd have it forever. He passed away in 2019 and I didn't get the chance to do that. So I asked one of my friends, Tom Daly, he's actually a fellow alumni at Bolton School, and he's a videographer, and I asked him to come to my grandma's and we'd interview my grandma. We interviewed my grandma, we got her life story, and we put it on film and we gave it to everybody for Christmas, all my family for Christmas, and everyone loved it. It was amazing. She talked about things she'd never shared with any of us, about rations during the war, about my granddad at the age of 12 cycling from Blackpool to Darwin to go and visit her over the summer holidays, but she wasn't there. So then he had to cycle all the way back, and a bunch of stuff that I will literally cherish forever. And then that took 3 years to develop an idea of that seed into what became Story Oak. So officially what we do is we capture people's real life stories and we give it back to their families and their friends for them to keep forever in a Netflix style documentary series. It's a really special product and it's a completely different to Tales to Inspire, the not-for-profit organization and that side of things, but it is based in the heart of storytelling, that we all have a story. And the question is, what are we gonna do with that story? So I know I've talked a little bit about my journey here. I don't have the answers. I definitely don't, but I'm sure as hell gonna ask as many questions as possible. That's my determination. What I always do is ask questions and try and develop as much as possible. Being an entrepreneur is essentially finding the gaps and not looking at the problems, but finding solutions. And one of the things that there's two things that I really want to talk about that are really important towards, for me, being an entrepreneur. And number one is essentially not always following the plan, because the plans don't always go to plan. Life isn't about following the plan. It's about knowing what to do when the plan doesn't go correctly. I've made so many plans as an entrepreneur. If I'd made a 5-year plan at the start of Tales to Inspire, I would never have got to where I am now, because it's gone that far off it. And the second one is literally what I said before, is seeing the solution. I've always had ideas. I've got a Google Drive of 250 business ideas. I tried to start a business in America when I was living there, but because of visa issues, I couldn't. But essentially, the thing that I'm trying to say is you have to spark ideas. You have to be a creative. I wasn't a creative at school. I was not typically good at music. I wasn't typically good at any of the arts or technology. But my God, can I make an idea? And can I see where that idea goes? And I can build that team together. So where am I going to go? So I'm going to go for the last bit in terms of entrepreneurship here and the perspective and the attributes that anyone really, I feel, has an ability. There's no ideal entrepreneur. Some entrepreneurs are incredible. You can look at Steve Jobs, look at the ideas he created, but was he great with people? Some people are great with people, but they don't have the drive to get where they need to. You can be an entrepreneur and you can take things in your own way, but the really important part of this is, why do you do what you do? I think it's a really important thing for me is every day I bring myself back to, why am I doing what I do? And that is the foundation and the starting point for me to go anywhere I need to. It can be very lonely, but actually it can also, on the other side, give me alone time, which I feel is really empowering. And it can bring up so many self-doubts, but it also can bring up so much confidence. So the question is really, where do you want your life to head? It can go in a million different directions. Entrepreneurialism is a great way, I'm completely biased, to go. But please make sure that you don't glorify it, that you do realize that as entrepreneurs, I probably work harder than anyone else I know in a regular 9-to-5 job, probably double. And that's common for many, many entrepreneurs, but also you can get so much out of it. So I'm just going to leave it at that. Thank you so much for having me today. And hopefully, please feel free to reach out.
Thanks, Chris. It was really, really inspiring to hear especially how your attitude's altered since leaving school. And I think that's really important for the young people on the call today. And to see this business grow that you've got so much passion for, really, really inspiring. Our final speaker is Catherine Swift, food and drink entrepreneur. Similarly, her life experiences led her to start her business, which is OMGT. Thanks, Catherine.
Hello, everybody. great to hear all of the wonderful entrepreneurial stories from Charlotte, Rob and Krish. I believe genuinely it's all about passion. Passion is what underpins successful entrepreneurial journeys. So after graduating at John Moores University in Modern Languages, I decided I didn't want to do anything with languages, and I ended up working in media and marketing. My first job was at the Manchester Evening News. Following on from there, I worked for The Independent, the Capital Radio Group, TalkSport, and then moved into event management until my path changed significantly. So why did I become an entrepreneur? For me, it was when I found something that I was so passionate about, something that I felt compelled to do something about, that's when things changed. If somebody had told me 12 years ago I'd be running a matcha tea business, you could have knocked me over with a feather. But the turning point for me was when I moved from working for corporate businesses focused on the bottom line to working in third sector, where I felt I was doing something that really mattered and would make a difference to people's lives. So Mum was diagnosed with stage 3 breast cancer in 2010, and I was totally floored by it. She was the heartbeat, still is actually, she's still here with us, which is great, heartbeat of our family. And as far as we were concerned, as fit as a fiddle. At the time, I was working in event management, and my biggest event was the Northwest Football Awards. So the day Mum was in hospital having a mastectomy, I was literally all over the place. And my husband, Jason, said to me, "You're doing yourself and your mum no good. You need to focus on work." So I decided to pick the phone up to a guy called Morris Watkins, who's a senior statesman in sports law, but also the chair of the judging panel of the Football Awards. And we were discussing the forthcoming judging day. And Morris at the time was the chair of a £20 million appeal for the new children's hospital in Manchester. And because we'd get the great and good of the world of football in the room on the night, we would always raise money and do quite well. So we'd been raising money for the children's hospital for the previous 3 years. And we got onto the subject of the charity, and I asked Morris if he'd like to continue to raise for the children's hospital. And he said they'd hit the target. And actually he'd been asked to head up a multi-million pound fundraising appeal for Breast Cancer Now. So it was just totally weird. Hairs on the back of my neck stood on end. I told him what was happening with my mum. We obviously raised for breakthrough breast cancer then, it's now Breast Cancer Now. We raised for the charity that year, but then Morris got me involved in the actual appeal, which was a major donor appeal. So rather than tin shaking outside supermarkets, I was actually running the appeal. We were identifying major donors, taking them around the research unit to meet the scientists and see the science in action. And it was inspirational. And the reason it was so inspirational was because it wasn't at that stage, a lot of it about, you know, creating new pharmaceutical drugs. It was about repurposing of drugs, but also Professor Michael Lisanti, who was the research director at the time, had a real interest in the potential of antioxidants in, you know, the potential treatment and curative effect they might have on various types of cancer. So that's where my interest in green tea started. I wanted Mum to drink the antioxidant green tea that they've shown to have an impact on cancer stem cells, it's called EGCG. So I wanted Mum to drink the green tea with the most EGCG in it. And because of how matcha is cultivated and processed, it was that tea. So it has about, they reckon about 130 times the EGCG of regular green tea. So that move, working for Breast Cancer Now, ultimately led me to founding OMGT and the Healthy Life Foundation. The Healthy Life Foundation is a charity that funds research into age-related diseases. We've raised £500,000 so far. Professor Michael Lisanti, who was the research director at Breast Cancer Now, is actually the research director of the charity. So that's where it all started for me, and it's all around belief and passion. In relation to entrepreneurialism, if I can say it, there's also obviously the potential for very large financial success, but this takes time. I think Charlotte definitely touched on this. It requires a lot of sacrifice and it involves risk. And I think if I didn't have the passion and belief in what I was doing, I would not have had the resilience to bring the business to where it is now. So you need to be prepared to take risks and be resilient. Things won't go the way you want them to go. Quite often they won't. And I've got two very good examples for me. One of them was a ready-to-drink product that we launched back in 2018 that just didn't work. Many sleepless nights, literal money drain. It was the wrong time for the drink. The consumer actually really liked it. The problem was we had a dosing cap on a bottle and the lid wouldn't fit onto the bottle properly. So the contract manufacturers doubled our prices. They were hurting their hands putting the caps on the bottle. It was just a total nightmare. So I think, again, if I hadn't had the passion and belief, I probably could have given up. I could have thrown the towel in then, but I didn't. I took another risk when I went on Dragon's Den in 2018. I was approached by the BBC. I never in a million years would have applied to go on the programme. And I'm not sure if this what's happened with you, Charlotte, but I got an email into my inbox in January 2018, identifying me as a business that would maybe work on Dragon's Den. And I felt ill reading it, but knew if I didn't go down that road, I'd always wonder what if. But that's another story. I didn't get investment. It was an amazing experience. I'm really glad I did it, but it nearly killed me. But again, I took what I thought was a calculated risk. Maybe I thought it didn't pay off at the time because I didn't get investment, but it was just such a great learning experience for me. And also now, looking back, I'm actually glad that I didn't get investment because the Dragons didn't actually really get what the business is about or what I was about. And there's stuff about to happen with the business that wouldn't be able to happen if I had had the investment. So, it's literally like that. The journey is up and down. Lots of highs, but also lots of lows. The obvious stuff is obviously it gives you flexibility, independence, job satisfaction. It's great being your own boss. I think in relation to what the future holds for those establishing a business today, for me, businesses need to have a purpose beyond profit. How could your business contribute to society and be a force for good? For us at OMGT, that looks like our Soil Association organic certification, our charitable affiliations through the Healthy Life Foundation, the charity I've mentioned that I founded, and Green the UK, a charity involved in the sea kelp restoration project off the coast of Sussex that we're currently involved with. We're also preparing to become B Corp certified that should happen this year. Secondly, I believe that being an authentic business by being true to your values and not just focusing on the bottom line is extremely important. Authenticity can make or break a brand success. And the stats say about 90% of consumers report that authenticity is one of the most important factors when they decide which brands they want to purchase. People want to know who they're working with, and they want to work with businesses that are ethical, sustainable, honourable. I genuinely believe these are the kinds of businesses that will be successful in the future. I love what I do, I live and breathe it, and I genuinely couldn't imagine doing anything else. My vision, though, for me is to grow OMGT into a big enough business for me to be able to take a step back eventually and spend my time fundraising for groundbreaking medical research. So that's me.
Hello there, good evening. Okay, thank you very much. They were some amazing speeches, really inspirational. So now we're going to just ask questions. I'm sure all you listeners out there have some things that you've learned from that and ideas that you've developed as you sat there thinking. This is the moment that you can ask those questions of the four entrepreneurs, and I will pass those questions across to them now. Now, I've just had one question to start us off, which I will bring up now. So this is says that in today's society, with new technology, what is the best way to promote in larger markets where there are dominant competitors? So if anyone would like to jump in there and answer that question, that'd be brilliant.
Well, that's a tough one.
just yes,
I'm definitely not qualified to answer that one, I'm afraid.
I think I think things have changed quite recently, and I don't think anyone's quite got to grips with it. I think social media, when it arose, which is a while ago now, but I think it became a very easy and quick way to get your voice out there, no matter who you were. But there've been so many changes recently with the increase in privacy, with the changes to iOS, meaning that you can't track people anymore, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, which make it a lot more expensive for businesses to market via social media, and a lot more difficult actually for smaller businesses compared to larger ones. So that would have been the answer a couple of years back, but now it has become an awful lot more difficult. And honestly, it's a hard question to answer. That the reason that I went on Dragon's Den, and Catherine's absolutely right, exactly the same thing happened to me. I was approached by them. I couldn't think of anything worse, almost said no, slept on it, and was like, I can't miss this chance because 3 million people watch every episode. And that's the kind of hack, growth hack it's known as, that enables you to get a much bigger profile than you could possibly afford. But it is the hardest thing about running a small business is you can't compete with the big guys because you don't have the money, and you have to raise investment to be able to spend on marketing to grow the business. But if you're not growing the business, it's hard to raise investment, and it's the toughest part of it. And it's something we're still struggling with every day. Sorry not to have a more positive answer to that, but yeah, it's absolutely the most difficult thing about running a small, particularly consumer business.
Thank you. Going to B2B,
it's much easier.
I agree, Charlotte. I also think though, what we talked about your credentials as a business, your sustainability, your authenticity, people are becoming a lot more savvy about how they interact with brands, and the kind of things that, you know, resonate with them are exactly those types of things. So that helps in a way. But again, it's getting in front of those audiences, which is the challenge. And yeah,
a strong brand, like Catherine says, means that people will remember you and you're more likely to stand out. And that's how you break through against the big guys. But yeah, you still got to get in front of them before they can have the chance to remember you and to feel that you resonate with them.
Hence the reason we went on Dragon's Den.
Exactly.
Okay, brilliant. Thank you very much for those answers. Quite another question here. To what extent do you feel that school and university in the UK prepared you for entrepreneurship, and do you think it's improved today compared to when you were younger?
I'm going to go for that one. So it didn't. I'm absolutely honest. I came to Bolton School. No, we'd never talked about entrepreneurialism at all. The good thing was that many of our parents were entrepreneurs. So my dad has a convenience store and a pharmacy and things like that. And then many of the other parents did. But then that's not just Bolton School. And I speak to young people in many schools now, thousands and thousands of young people throughout the whole country. And entrepreneurialism, you look at people and say entrepreneur, and still, and this is teachers as well, look at me like, what's that word mean? And it's a really interesting that we get taught to get jobs. And it's something that it's a systematic thing that we get taught to get jobs. You may have a different opinion of this here, and that's more than welcome. But from what I've experienced myself, the way that schools, and I got a degree in business in the US. Once again, it was a tiny, tiny bit on entrepreneurialism, and everything else was about really business administration. So it was something that from that point of view that I feel that it's not exactly where it needs to be to help people become independent.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think I went to Cambridge, which is held up as the best university in the UK, and it was an amazing place to go to university, but it absolutely beat the entrepreneurial spirit out of me because I couldn't, and this just is about the skill set. I wasn't even able to, you know, I was writing my dissertation. I was answering exam questions and trying to put my own spin on it. This is what I think. And I was being marked down because I wasn't parroting facts. And I had a professor say to me, we just want you to learn the facts and regurgitate them. Because for them to mark things which, you know, went off on a tangent and which tried to bring in innovative and original thinking, they couldn't mark that. And they wanted to get on with their own research. And they really just wanted undergrads to kind of tick the boxes and go through the process. And you get your 2-1 and I got a 2-2 because I was trying constantly to bring in my own thinking. They were like, we don't want to know that. If you do an MA or you do a PhD, fine, but not as an undergrad. I'm still so glad I went because of the people that I met. And actually a lot of being an entrepreneur is using your contacts and your network and talking to people and learning from them. But I didn't learn anything from school or university. But, you know, that was the 90s as well that I was at school. So it was a different time.
I guess that's where these evenings like tonight are opportunities that just weren't around when you were younger, and all the schemes in school where the students can get involved in trying to develop these entrepreneurial skills together with what they're doing academically and then applying it in the real world in these sorts of examples. So hopefully more and more of those opportunities will come up.
Yeah. I mean, I you know, that is exactly why we've put in place the entrepreneurship scheme. And I do think that talking to people who, you know, we've only run it for 2 years now, but talking to some of the people who've been through it, I think it is beneficial because it opens people's eyes, young people's eyes, to the fact that, you know, there is a different path. You don't have to just prepare for a career in a particular profession. You can really think outside the box. You can really go and find people who are passionate about things that you're passionate about. And, you know, you can really go and change the world. And I think, you know, increasingly you have to do that anyway, because actually careers, jobs for life don't exist anymore. We have no idea what people are going to be doing in 5 years or 10 years or 20 years time in any of the professions. We just have no clue. So there's no point in just teaching, you know, to pursue a career in a profession, because we don't even know whether that profession is going to exist in 10 years or 20 years time, or what form it's going to take. So I would really advocate for thinking for yourself. I would advocate for, you know, trying to find things that you care about, because if you care about them, then it's likely other people will care about them. And many of the things that people have talked about social good and about you know, recognizing, you know, opportunities to do something beyond just make some money, I think is really, really important. I mean, I would advocate, you know, I would say the most important thing in a business is not to do anything that's bad in the sense that if you said to me, here's a business that is, you know, looking to make a profit and it doesn't have any kind of social enterprise aspect to it at all, I wouldn't say that's an awful business. But I think if there's anything which goes beyond that into something which actually affects people's lives negatively or affects the future negatively, then we should be shunning those businesses, whether we're thinking small or big. I mean, we should be trying to vote with our feet and avoid that kind of thinking.
Well, thank you very much for that. Plenty of questions are coming in now, so I'll ask one of them, which is a question of Suleiman's, is how do you identify problems? I guess this is the idea of you trying to evolve in various ways of solving problems that face society, and just, I guess he's asked after ideas of how do you come up with your own ideas?
Is the question more about how do you identify problems in the business, or is it identifying problems to create?
I think it's about, it says in the market. So I think I'm pretty sure he's talking about the things that you as businesses can solve to meet the needs of society, I guess.
There are frameworks for doing this, and there are kind of processes that you can look at and go through. But I think one of the most straightforward things to do is just talk to other people about, especially people who share a similar interest to you, a passion that you might want to pursue, and try and talk to them about the issues that whatever they might be in that area, whether it's anything, health or, well, anything. Because that will throw up ideas. I mean, it basically comes from engaging with people, whether you do that in a one-to-one way or whether you do it in a kind of market research way. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, ideas come from people's needs.
I think nearly all of us started a business based on our own experiences, our own lived experiences, mm-hmm. problems that we encountered. And I think they're the most powerful problems to solve. It gives you a fantastic story. It gives you the passion. You need passion to be an entrepreneur, because there will be hard times and you've got to keep going. And if you believe in the problem and genuinely feel it to your core, it makes it so much harder to get through those times. I think the watch out for me is always You're absolutely right that you must go out and speak to people about it and ask them what problems they're facing. But what you must never do is ask them what solution they want, because they will only ever tell you a solution that they're already aware of. So if I ask people, how do I solve the problem of children's clothing waste? They might say secondhand clothing, but they're not going to think about clothing rental. They're not, because they don't know it. It doesn't exist yet. So you're only going to end up with solutions that already exist, which you can make better. But you need to hear what the problem is. And then you need to be innovative in thinking about how you solve that problem. So ask everyone what their problems are. Don't necessarily ask them what solution they'd like.
And then I think, you know, it's about validating that when you come up with your idea, you need to get it validated. So whether that be focus groups or whatever, I mean, I think the stat is, I reckon there's about 190, nearly 200, you know, entrepreneur or business accelerators in the UK. And a lot of people just go in there with ideas, and those ideas, a lot of them will change. People will pivot. And that's through being within that ecosystem that allows people to share knowledge. And it's just a really, really good thing to get from my perspective. I was part of Entrepreneurial Spark and then the NatWest Entrepreneurial Accelerator. And they're just great environments to be in, to bounce ideas off, you know, peers and to, you know, to come up with solutions to problems. But then if your business idea isn't working, you've got a safe place where, you know, you can sound the ideas and people will, you know, tell you what's what, and you can quickly, you know, pivot and change what you're doing to suit what's going to be more relevant.
Yeah.
Brilliant. Thank you. All right, okay, we've got at the moment we've got about four other questions. I hope that's all right with everyone. This next question is about languages. Have languages ever been a problem when communicating on a large scale? And kind of linked to that, is it worth having a knowledge of other languages?
Japanese for me.
Has that been a barrier?
No, well, not really. Because, well, actually, to be fair, you know, the Japanese, a lot of them don't speak English, but we get a translator when we go over there. I would love to be able to speak Japanese. It's not essential, you know. At the end of the day, you'll find a way. You will get, you know, translators to accompany you to, you know, meetings, or whether that be sort of online meetings. It's, yeah, and you can't go out there trying to learn every language in the world. It's, you know, it's impossible. So yeah, and a lot of people do speak English.
Okay, and the next question is, it looks like all the panel have made a great success of your businesses, but this student believes a very high percentage of new businesses fail. And I think some of you talked about things you tried out and hadn't worked out. Are there any thoughts on how you know when to accept defeat and move on?
This is a really live one for me. We found out 2 days ago that we'd lost investment because the investor has become incredibly ill, and they were meant to sign the deal next week. And we've just lost £100,000 in investment, which we need. And I'm literally deciding this week whether to stop the business or not. So you face these issues constantly. And I'm literally like, I don't know which way to go. Can I cut my costs and try and limp on, but then face the fact that I'm not going to be able to scale it, so I won't be able to get more investment in future? Or do I just cut my losses? And it's the most painful and difficult part of being an entrepreneur, but you face it a lot. And how do you know when to accept defeat? Oh god, you don't. I mean, sometimes you just, it's forced on you. I think, you know, actually, if you are continuing to talk to your customer and you are listening to the problems and you're still hearing that problem's there and you're still hearing that you're solving it, it gives you a lot more fight to keep going when you face these things. But sometimes you don't have any choice, and, you know, we might not be here in 2 weeks' time. And it's, you know, it's like that. That's business. And it's, yeah, it's tough.
Thank you for that. Next question is about networking. How do you network effectively? Are there any top tips on that?
Well, I can try and answer that one to some degree. I mean, I think there are a lot of you know, kind of networking opportunities around. It very much depends, you know, you have to be quite targeted like anything else. So if you're looking to raise money, Then there are networks of investors out there. You just have to kind of look for them in your region, or, you know, depends on what level of fundraising you're trying to do. If you're thinking about networking into other businesses, so, you know, maybe it's B2B and you want to try and sell something across other businesses, then there are, you know, there are a lot of different ways to do that. Often industries have a kind of organization, they might have events. So I think it's very much like almost everything to do with kind of sales and marketing. You've got to be quite targeted. You can waste an awful lot of time talking to the wrong people or trying to, you know, kind of get involved with something that actually isn't going to help you at all. So you've got to really think hard about how to spend your time and how to work efficiently. And try, you know, and also just ask if there are other people that you know who are in the same industry, other businesses, you know, just try and drum up a conversation with them at some opportune moment and find out what they've done, how they've, you know, sometimes people clam up completely if they think you're a competitor, but other times people are quite open and, you know, it's just a people to people thing. There's no rules, I think.
People like to help, and I think you've not got to be afraid of asking for help. Yeah. But I do think you've got to ask for something very clear. You can't just go to somebody, particularly someone who might be very busy with their business, and say, "Hi, I'd just like to chat." I think it's quite key to say, "This is me. This is why I want to speak to you. This is what I think you can help me with." And then people are much more likely to say, "Okay, yes, I can help with that. This is not going to be a waste of my time." But generally, people do like to help, and you know, never be afraid to reach out to people who you think are in the right space.
Brilliant, thank you. And two remaining questions. This is from Freya asking, how important is it to have a degree in entrepreneurship or getting straight into the marketplace? So the idea of education again versus going into business when you have the idea.
I think that's a really difficult question to answer because I've no idea, you know, what a degree in entrepreneurship looks like. All I know is that, you know, hands-on is the best experience. Being in the business, working on the business, is how you learn best.
Yeah, I'd say degrees are becoming less important as apprenticeships rise, and there are other ways to demonstrate that early capability. You are going to have to compete in a jobs market with other people. So I would say having a degree can still be an advantage, but not in entrepreneurship. Do a degree in something you love and you're passionate about that you're going to do well in. That's where you're going to meet people. It's where you're going to get ideas. It's where you're going to have a great time. and you'll come out of it hopefully with a good result, and you'll be able to go and talk about that and what you've achieved when you go to an interview with a company where you'll get hands-on. Don't be afraid to start at the bottom to do an internship and just work in an area that you're passionate about. And that's the most important. But I think it is still helpful to have a degree or some sort of qualification, because you've got to break through all the other people that are wanting to volunteer and that are wanting to help out. So you do have to be able to demonstrate some level of capability.
Thank you.
There's a kind of credibility, I think, as well, which is the same thing, really. But, you will find some people. It matters to some people, and they may be people that matter. So if you're going to try and sell your services to somebody, and it may matter to them that you're qualified in a particular way. So it very much depends what you're trying to do, really.
Thank you. The final question is, how do you manage the work to personal life balance, a work-life balance? Is it difficult to manage time for friends, family, and hobbies? Obviously, Chris was talking about how extremely busy he is, so I'm interested to see what you all think.
Balance? What's balance?
Oh my God, work life? What's that?
I find balance one end of the scale and then at the other end of the scale.
Yeah, I think that's why it's so important to do something that you're passionate about again, because absolutely, you will work all the hours and you'll want to work all the hours. You know, I'm going away in 2 weeks on holiday. The laptop will be with me and I'll do at least 2 hours work a day, but I'll do it sitting on a sun lounger and it'll be nice and my kids will be running around and, you know, but you don't have a massive amount of balance, especially in the early days when you've got to do everything yourself because you can't afford other people to do it for you.
Brilliant. Well, thank you very much for all those answers. And I will pass over, I think it's to, is it Maya or Lynn who's going to come in now?
It's Maya who's coming in now.
Oh, brilliant. Hi, Maya.
Perfect. I would just like to share my thanks to everyone who has attended the lecture tonight, but in particular our guest speakers. Charlotte, I found it really interesting when you spoke about the your alternative definition to entrepreneurship and the different aspects that you thought were important, not just the profitability of the business. Thanks to you as well, Rob, and your point that you can follow entrepreneurial ideas throughout all careers, but also the importance of finding and following your passion throughout the entirety of your life. Krish, I found it very inspirational hearing you reflect upon your past priorities and lifestyle, but the massive turnaround that you've had to becoming really selfless and compassionate and dedicating yourself to others and how you express these priorities within your businesses. And finally, Catherine, speaking about how passion and belief fueled your idea, but also touching upon how much dedication and risk there is to starting a business was incredibly insightful to us all. I'd like to just say thank you all again, and I'd like to pass over to Mr. Kyle.
So one final thank you then to all of our panellists and for you and the audience for joining us too. I hope you found it informative and useful. Thank you very much. A good night.